Morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Well, good to see you here this morning. Just a couple of announcements as we get started. There will be no congregational luncheon going deeper next week, but we will be having our annual members meeting next week. So please, if you are a member of Red Mills, put that on your calendar and make plans to stay for a few minutes after the service as we go over some of the business of the church and update you on the ministries of the church and what God is doing amongst us. This week, as far as midweek Bible studies go, will be normal. The following week, there will be no midweek meetings. I'll be away at a conference, so we'll send reminders about that as well. Gentlemen, June 1st, of course, our monthly men's breakfast. June 8th, the ladies' study on the names of God will continue. So please jot those things down on your calendars. Psalm 95, verses 1 through 3 says this: O come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout joyfully to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving. Let us shout joyfully to him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. Father, indeed you are. You are the great one. And we come together to worship you and to proclaim that, Father. We come because we desire to give you praise, to adore you. And Father, we pray that you would move within your people to open us to your word today as well. We desire not only to give you praise and honor and worship, but to receive from you also as your word is read, as your word is proclaimed. Father, we pray that you would accomplish good and great things for us today. In Jesus' name, amen. Together, shall we? Let's stand together. Unending need.
Jesus said that if I
thank you for Jesus.
Yes.
Father, thank you that there is none other. There is no one stronger, and there is no one kinder. And we are grateful, Father. Let's remain standing for the reading of the Word of God.
Well, praise God. We are continuing our reading through the book of Ezekiel. We'll be reading chapter 22, verses 1 through 16. Hear the word of the Lord. Then the word of the Lord came to me, saying, "And you, son of man, will you judge? Will you judge the bloody city? Then cause her to know her abominations? You shall say, 'Thus says the Lord,' a city shedding blood in her midst, so that her time will come, and that makes idols contrary to her interest for defilement. You have become guilty by the blood which you have shed, and defiled by your idols which you have made. Thus you have brought your day near, and have come to your years. Therefore I have made you a reproach to the nations, and a mocking to all the lands. Those who are near and those who are far from you will mock you. You of ill repute, full of turmoil. Behold, the rulers of Israel, each according to his power, have been in you for the purpose of shedding blood. They have treated father and mother lightly within you. The alien they have oppressed in your midst, the fatherless and the widow they have wronged in you. You have despised all your things and profaned my Sabbaths. Slanderous men have been in you for the purpose of shedding blood, and in you they have eaten at the mountain shrines. In your midst they have committed acts of lewdness. In you they have uncovered their father's nakedness. In you they have humbled her who was unclean in her menstrual impurity. One has committed abomination with his neighbor's wife, and another has lewdly defiled his daughter-in-law, and another in you has humbled his sister, his father's daughter. In you they have taken bribes to shed blood. You have taken interest in profits, and you have endured your neighbors for gain, injured your neighbors for gain by oppression, and you have forgotten me, declares the Lord. Behold then, I smite my hand at your dishonest gain, which you have acquired, and at the bloodshed which is among you. Can your heart endure, or can your hands be strong in the day that I will deal with you? I, the Lord, have spoken and will act. I will scatter you among the nations, and I will disperse you throughout the lands, and I will consume your uncleanliness from you. You will profane yourself in the sight of the nations, and you will know that I am the Lord." This is the word of the Lord. You may be seated. So last week, if you recall, as we were reading, we were introduced to God's instrument of judgment, which is the nation of Babylon. God will use her to punish Israel. God is going to pour out his wrath by giving over the people into the hands of the Babylonians. And the reason that this is going to happen is explained right here in our passage. This is an issue of purity. You'll notice the repetition of defiled in verses 3 through 5 and in verse 11 is at the center of the issue with the people. All of this leads to the unethical and ritual impurity of Israel. Look at verse 6. It says, "Behold, the rulers of Israel, each according to his power, have been in you for the purpose of shedding blood." That is, in you is in Jerusalem. All the sins on this long list occurs every single day. It has become a way of life, a lifestyle, and every area of life is affected. These sins violate God's law for protection of worship, parental authority, human marriage, property, and truth. In short, they include all the matters addressed in the Ten Commandments. So, why is this happening? Well, verse 12 tells us clearly, "You have forgotten me," declares the Lord. The reason for this defiled way of living is because Israel has forgotten her God, who's provided for her continually. When the people forgot God, when they forget God, it has ramifications. Ramifications that affect every part of life in a given society. John Calvin, a French theologian, pastor, and reformer, a gifted teacher, whose main tenets are explained with the acronym TULIP, says this: the T in TULIP addresses the total depravity of man. Total depravity says that sin is so twisted us that apart from the grace of God, we love other things more than God. Our minds, our body, our affections, our spirit, every part of us has been affected by sin, and of our own accord, we cannot escape this predicament. But God has, however, never stopped loving his creation. You recall John 3:16-17, as we're told, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send the Son into the world to judge the world, but that the world might be saved through him." So, earlier I referenced the Ten Commandments as evidence of Israel's defilement. She forgot God, therefore broke all his laws openly. The law of God, just as it was then and now, was always meant as a tutor for us, to guide us in right relationship with God, to guide us in right relationship with our neighbors and to the truth. The truth being that we're all sinners who cannot keep the law. Thus, we are in need of a Savior. This was the problem. Israel forgot this. Verse 12 is a warning for us not to repeat the same error, but to keep our eyes fixed on God as the object of our eyes, our affection. He's our North Star, in a matter of saying. Because if we don't keep our eyes on him, we risk falling into a sinful lifestyle like that of ancient Israel that affects everything that we think, that we say, and that we do. Now, in his love, God made available to us by his Spirit the means to overcome and live a lifestyle pleasing to him. The evidence of this is summed up in the two great commandments: love God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and love your neighbors as yourselves. So, let us live in such a way which is evident that we, as part of a community of believers who have been called by God, love one another, care for one another, look out for one another. Because the alternative way of living in open defilement against God and one another leads to eternal destruction. But God is full of mercy and grace. The fact that we have these examples and warnings for us is for our benefit and greatly displays his magnificent grace. So, I want you to hold fast to it and never let go of his grace. Amen.
Amen. Our gracious God and Father, we read these words which our brother has just read for us, as the Lord tells Israel, "You have forgotten me." Father, we are stopped in our tracks. Can there be any more tragic words uttered? You have forgotten me. And the temptation for us is to listen to that, to read that, think, oh, those old Israelites, there they go again. When what we should be thinking is, how often have I forgotten God? We confess to you this morning, Father, that we are a people who do forget you. We listen to the voice of the world, we get caught up in the busyness of our lives, into the things that come to us calling for our attention, and so often, Father, particularly in regard to sin, we forget you. We put you out of our minds and pursue that which captures our hearts. Forgive us, Father. Forgive us, we are not yet what you will make us to be. Cause us, Father, to return to our first love, to love you above all else, to have our mind stayed upon you. This, Father, we ask in Christ's name, for his sake and for our good. Amen. Please turn with me to Psalm 9 this morning. Psalm 9, looking at the first 10 verses. I will give thanks to the Lord with all my heart. I will tell of all your wonders. I will be glad and exult in you. I will sing praise to your name, O Most High. When my enemies turn back, they stumble and perish before you. For you have maintained my just cause. You have sat on the throne judging righteously. You have rebuked the nations. You have destroyed the wicked. You have blotted out their name forever and ever. The enemy has come to an end in perpetual ruins, and you have uprooted the cities. The very memory of them has perished. But the Lord abides forever. He has established his throne of judgment, and he will judge the world in righteousness. He will execute judgment for the peoples with equity. The Lord also will be a stronghold for the oppressed, a stronghold in times of trouble. And those who know your name will put their trust in you. For you, O Lord, have not forsaken those who seek you. Father, as we read the words of the psalmist, we see him thinking back to when you preserved him from his enemies. When you, sitting on your righteous throne, judged them. But Father, he understands that what he has experienced in his own life of your justice and the defense of your people against their enemies, that is but a foretaste of what is to come. For you are the eternal God. And what you have done here in this world, you will do, Father, at the consummation of all things. For the psalmist goes on to tell us that you will, in the future, judge the world in righteousness. You will execute judgment for the peoples with equity. You will be a stronghold for the oppressed, a stronghold in the times. You, Father, you will be the defense of your people, and we are so grateful for this. We know, Father, that you keep your promises. You are faithful and just. But until that time of judgment, it is a time of grace. Grace is available. Father, you have called us to take the gospel to the ends of the earth. So we pray for the work of the gospel in this world as you build your kingdom. We pray, Father, for Jonathan and Liesl as they minister the gospel in that place where there is no other gospel witness. Father, we pray that you would give them fruit. Give them wisdom and boldness. We pray. Father, we pray for the Asipali Hostel there in India as well. We We pray that through their ministry that many young people might continue to come to a knowledge of the Savior. We pray your protection as well, Father. For there is no little danger there in that place for those who proclaim the gospel. There is opposition, Father, from Islam and from Hinduism. We pray, Father, you would sustain them and keep them faithful in that place. We pray for the persecuted church around the world, that they might maintain their witness even in the face of opposition and hardship. Father, we know that all of your promises will come to pass. The day is coming when Jesus will break through the clouds and he will return, and the dead in Christ will rise, Father. Resurrection will occur for both the righteous and the wicked, and you will judge the wicked. You will usher your people into the new heaven and the new earth. And we are so grateful, Father. We look forward to that great day. Until that day comes, may we stand firmly in the faith which has been delivered once and for all. May we not be ashamed of Jesus Christ or his gospel. And may we work, Father, as there is still day, that the kingdom might be built, that you might be glorified, that the name of Jesus might be made known. For it is in his name that we ask it. Amen. Gentlemen, you come forward, please. Father, we continue our worship this morning with our gifts. It is worship indeed. Come before you recognizing that all that we have, all that we are, is from your good hand. Every gift, James tells us, comes from you. We know that to be true. So we don't give you anything you need. You need nothing from us. We give in recognition that you are the giver. And we give, Father, with the understanding that you will build your kingdom and you will do it through your people. And we want to be a part of that process. And so take these gifts, Father, and use them to make the gospel known. In Jesus' name, amen.
Continue in our worship service. This is that time where I ask you, out of respect for the Word of God, to silence your electronic devices as we listen to the Word of the Lord. Father, we do thank you and pray that as the pastor communicates the Word of God, which he has been entrusted. instructions that we can apply to our lives to be faithful citizens of the kingdom of God. We pray that you might be glorified in all that is said from your word this day. Amen.
This morning in discipleship, we were talking briefly about the fact that there are those in other parts of the world that have paid a price for proclaiming what God has said in His Word. There are pastors in parts of Europe, in Canada, that have been fined and put in jail for stating what the Bible says. And I mentioned in that discussion that we will continue here simply to go to the next passage and the next passage and the next passage, because we want to proclaim the whole counsel of God, no matter what. So this morning we go to the next passage. You would open your Bibles to 1 Timothy chapter 6. We're going to be looking at verses 11 through 16 in our study of not only the first epistle of Paul to Timothy, but the pastoral epistles altogether. So you know where we're going when we're done with 1 Timothy. We're going to 2 Timothy. But this morning, we're going to look at chapter 6, verses 11 through 16. Let me read that for us. But flee from these things, you man of God, and pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, perseverance, and gentleness. Fight the good fight of faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called, and you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. I charge you in the presence of God, who gives life to all things, and of Christ Jesus, who testified the good confession before Pontius Pilate, that you keep the commandment without stain or reproach until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he will bring about at the proper time, he who is the blessed and only sovereign, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who alone possesses immortality and dwells in unapproachable light, whom no man has seen or can see. To him be honor and eternal dominion. Amen. And to this, Father, we say amen. You are to be honored. You are the God of eternal dominion. Father, let us hear from you today in your word. Father, all that I speak, which is in accord with your word, drive home to our hearts and minds. And if I should say anything that is not in accord with your word, wipe it from our memories, we ask. In Christ's name, amen. Paul, as you know, often used military metaphors in his writings. He speaks about Christians as soldiers. And here in this passage, though he's not being quite so obvious about it as he is in some other passage, there is a military quality to what Paul is writing to Timothy. He is, after all, to fight the good fight. God's given his church what we might refer to as rules of engagement. And these rules not only have personal application to Timothy as a minister, but they also help every Christian to know how to do that, to fight the good fight of faith. And it's something we need to learn, it's something we need to understand, because the fact that we have to fight a good fight means we are in a battle. Life is not easy, just generally speaking, but the Christian life is all the more difficult. We live in a world that does not understand us. We are, to use King James language, a peculiar people. That's what the world thinks of. And living faithfully for Christ in this world is often difficult. Simply by virtue of the fact that we live in a fallen world, that makes things difficult. We are seeking to serve Christ when we are at the same time not only battling the world, not only battling the devil, but battling ourselves. Scripture refers to our flesh. We're constantly at war with ourselves. People often use the old, I'm going to date myself here, the old Flip Wilson excuse. Some of you will remember him. The devil made me do it. And my question is, why do you need the devil? I don't. I have enough problems with myself. But we live in a fallen world. We're struggling with all kinds of different things, not only with ourselves spiritually and our flesh, but often physically. Some of us, I know, are in constant pain. We're constantly struggling with things of the body, not to mention the mind and the spirit. And it distracts us. It's hard to think of other things when your body is in pain. There's all kinds of reasons why life is difficult. And Paul comes and says, you need to recognize you're in a fight. You're in a battle. Don't think that it's peacetime. If you think it's peacetime and then the struggles come, you're not going to know what to do about it, because you're going to think something's wrong when it's just the norm. It's life. It's the Christian life. Go back and read Romans 7. Paul talks about himself and the struggles that he has, even the great apostle Paul. I do those things I don't want to do, and I don't do the things I do want to do. And there's a battle going on within. We're in a fight. And so Paul writes to Timothy to remind him of this and to instruct him concerning how to live the Christian life in wartime. So we want to take this that Paul says to Timothy and bring it to ourselves. Because there's nothing that Paul says to Timothy that doesn't also apply to us. So what does Paul say? Well, the first thing he says that a soldier needs to know is what dangers to avoid. Good soldiers do not knowingly and carelessly walk into minefields. And so Timothy's first rule of engagement is an order to make a tactical withdrawal. You see that in verse 11. Flee from these things, you man of God. Each word in that phrase is significant. Notice, the verse begins with the word but. So we've got a contrast between what Paul is about to say to Timothy and what he has already said. If you remember from last week, that which Paul was saying to Timothy had to do with false teachers. What they taught, and how they live. But now, Paul's shifting. So, Timothy, I just told you about false teachers. This is what they're like. This is who they are. This is what they do. But you are not to be like them. You're to be different. You're to go a different way. And so you, Timothy, flee from these things. Flee from the things that I was just talking about in the context of false teachers. Every time they appear, run. Stay away from them. Avoid these things. So Paul is, in this immediate context, drawing a contrast between the true and false ministry of the gospel. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, for example, Paul warns Timothy that evil people and imposters will go on from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and firmly believed. A little bit beyond that in 2 Timothy. He says the time is coming when people will not endure sound doctrine. As for you, always be sober-minded, endure suffering, do the work of an evangelist, fulfill your ministry. We know very well that there are many false teachers in the world. There always have been. There always will be until Christ returns. But a man like Timothy, a man of God, must have nothing to do with them. When others are false, Timothy must remain true. When others take ministry as a professional career, he must receive it as a sacred calling. When others teach the wisdom of the world, Timothy is to teach the wisdom of God. When others preach themselves, Timothy will preach Christ crucified and risen from the dead. What makes Timothy different is that he is, as Paul refers to him, a man of God. Flee from these things, you man of God. That may be the highest commendation that Paul ever gave to young Timothy. Who of us who love Christ would not want to be called a man or woman of God? The title man of God is used rarely in the Old Testament. It's reserved there almost exclusively for heroes of the faith. Men like Moses and Samuel and David and Elijah and Elisha. Like those great men who came before him, Timothy has been given a message to proclaim. Like them, he has got to remain true in the face of danger. If he remains faithful at his post, then he too can be called a man of God. That's what a man of God is, after all. It's not an office. I'm not a man of God because I hold an office. I hope I am a man of God because I'm faithful. But that means that every one of us can or should desire to be a man or woman of God, because each one of us can be faithful in the place where God has placed us. What the man of God is told to do is to flee these things, and by these things, as we've said, Paul clearly means the things that he's just been warning about in chapter 6, verses 3 through 10. He is to turn away, run away from the love of money and all of the fruits of that inordinate love, discontent, foolish desire, dissension, false doctrine. He must not be greedy. When it comes to money, he should follow the example of the Apostle Paul, who knew when to run. Paul recognized, of course, that pastors need their daily bread. He's even defended their right to draw a salary from those to whom they minister. We saw this back in chapter 5, verse 17 and 18. Elders who rule well are to be considered worthy of double honor, especially those who are part of preaching and teaching. For the scripture says, "You shall not muzzle the ox while he is threshing, and the laborer is worthy of his wages." So Paul says it's good and it's proper for the people of God to support those who minister to them in the work of the gospel. But that's not why they do it. Timothy is not to be in the ministry for money. Paul understood this. So when he said his farewell to the elders from Timothy's church in Acts chapter 20, he was able to state with a clear conscience that he had coveted no one's silver or gold. When it comes to the love of money and its associated dangers, it's not enough to walk away. Paul says, you've got to flee. Run from those things that will destroy your ministry. Now, there's more to avoiding sin than simply beating a hasty retreat. If all we do is run away from one sin, we're going to run right into another. That's how sin works in this world and in our hearts. Real growth in godliness replaces the don'ts with the do's. It means getting rid of vices, but then also replacing them with virtues. And so watch what Paul does here in verse 11. Flee from these things, you man of God, and pursue. Both flee and pursue. And what makes the distinction there is what you are fleeing and what you are pursuing. Flee from these things that I just told you about that are in relation to false teachers, but pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, perseverance, and gentleness. So Timothy is given six specific things here to pursue. This isn't an exhaustive list. Most of the time, when we're reading through Scripture, we come across lists. It's not exhaustive. They are examples. Paul could have added a lot of other things, I'm sure. But this is what he focuses on. And I think it's a good list. If you focus on these things, I think it's probably going to include most other things that Paul could have included here. He is to pursue righteousness. This has to do with one's conduct before other human beings. It means to be upright, to handle one's responsibilities at home, at work, at the church, and everywhere else with complete integrity. He says, pursue godliness. Well, that has to do with one's piety before God. This is one of Paul's favorite words in this epistle. In one form or another, it appears 8 times more than anywhere else in the Bible. It's in 1 Timothy that we're told to lead peaceable, quiet lives, lives of godliness and dignity. The gospel itself is the mystery of godliness, Paul says. Godliness is of value in every way. There is great gain, not in pursuing money, but in godliness with contentment. One of the main messages of this entire epistle is that Timothy ought to train himself for godliness. Paul goes on to say, Timothy, don't forget also to pursue faith and love. And these are included whenever Paul speaks about the cardinal virtues of the Christian life. But also perseverance. This is the ability to endure in difficult times, to persist. And boy, did Timothy need that. Timothy had all kinds of issues going on in the church of Ephesus that he, as the pastor, needed to deal with. And so Paul wanted to make sure that Timothy understood. First of all, when there are problems in the church, don't be surprised. I mean, we just look around. The church is made up of us. We bring problems into the church. So Timothy has to understand this. You're dealing with human beings. You're dealing with fallen human beings. You're dealing with imperfectly sanctified human beings. We're going to have trouble. There's going to be problems. Don't be surprised, persevere. endure. In one's personal life, it's the same way. If you have this utopian idea that life should be easy, you are going to be sadly disappointed. And when troubles come, you're going to be surprised. You're not going to know how to deal with it. Listen, life is trouble. Expect it. And deal with it as a godly man or woman. Don't throw up your hands and give up. Persevere. Persist. This is the staying power that is necessary for the kind of military campaign in which Timothy is engaged. But at the same time, I think this is great, Paul concludes this list with the characteristic of gentleness. This is not typically considered a desirable quality in a soldier. The poster at the Army recruiting office does not say, "We're looking for a few gentle men." But gentleness has great value in the church, and never more so when dealing with doctrinal error. In his next epistle to Timothy, Paul will advise Timothy in regard to how to correct opponents. And he specifically says, Timothy, you do that with gentleness. Even though Timothy must stand up to false teachers, there is a proper way to do it. And that way is not with harshness, but with gentleness. Because after all, what is the goal? Even with false teachers who come into the church, the goal is to correct them, to bring them to truth, to bring them to repentance. And that is not done with harshness, but with gentleness. Jonathan Edwards once wrote this: "It is the duty of God's people to be steadfast and vigorous in their opposition to the designs and ways of such as are endeavoring to overthrow the kingdom of Christ and the interest of religion. If therefore we see any of the followers of Christ in the midst of the most violent, unreasonable, and wicked opposition of God's and his own enemies, maintaining under all this temptation the humility and quietness and gentleness of a lamb, and the harmlessness and love and sweetness of a dove, we may well judge that here is a good soldier of Christ Jesus." So even as we're dealing with those who stand in opposition to the truth, opposition to Christ, opposition to his church, the way you tell the good soldier of Jesus Christ is that they conduct themselves with gentleness. It's exactly the opposite of what the world would tell you. Righteousness, gentleness, faith, love, godliness, perseverance, the man of God pursues these things. These attributes are doubly necessary for a minister of the gospel. Entering the ministry means more than merely preaching the gospel. It means also the consecration of one's whole life to the service of God. It means a holiness of life and speech far exceeding that expected of one in a less responsible sphere of influence. Now, so far, Paul has given Timothy two rules of engagement, one for flight, one for pursuit. Next, he gives him one for actual combat. Fight the good fight of faith. Now this command has to do with doctrine. What the Christian fights for is the faith, meaning the truth, meaning orthodoxy. It is the faith which has been delivered once for all to the saints. It is what Paul has previously described earlier in this chapter as the sound words of the Lord Jesus Christ. The faith is the body of doctrine about salvation in Christ, which was taught by the apostles and then recorded in the pages of the New Testament. And here, Scripture brings together two things that can never be separated. Verse 12 is about Christian doctrine, whereas the previous verse was about the Christian life. And those things go together. What have we seen already? We've seen that those who teach falsely also live falsely. Conversely, those who hold to true doctrine ought to have lives that are consistent with that doctrine. Keep a close watch, Paul told Timothy back in chapter 4, on yourself and on the teaching. Life and doctrine, they go together. Doctrine without life is dead orthodoxy. Life without doctrine is reckless faith, ungrounded faith, unanchored faith. But put life together with doctrine, add the ethical to the theological, and you get the light and the heat of authentic Christianity. Christianity is both. Don't listen to those who will say, I don't care about theology, just give me practical instruction. Tell me how to live my best life now. You cannot be obedient to Jesus Christ without doctrine. Doctrine is simply truth. And it must be preserved. It must be defended. The word Paul uses here for fighting is the Greek word for struggle. Agonizo. It sometimes refers to an athletic competition, such as a boxing match or a wrestling match. You might hear it in the phrase. It's the Greek word from which we get the word agony. It's to work, it's to train, it's to agonize so that we are equipped to defend the truth. Here, it can be taken in a military sense, especially since it echoes a similar command from the beginning of the letter. What this rule means, rather obviously, is that there are times when Christians, especially Christian ministers, will have to fight for the truth. Not that they are belligerent about it, has to go along with the gentleness that Paul's already discussed, but there is a fight to be fought, and every loyal soldier of Christ must engage in the battle. Calvin said, Christ calls his servants to warfare. An army which lacks the courage to fight must either surrender or be defeated. And sadly, there were men in the church at Ephesus who lacked the courage to fight for the truth. Instead of defending the faith, they simply wandered away from it. This is what Paul says down in verse 21. Some have professed and thus gone astray from the faith. They have professed falsehood. Instead of fighting for the truth, they've given themselves over to a lie, and they've gone astray as a result. Yeah. Not many of us like to fight. If someone likes to fight, there's an issue there. But there are things worth fighting for. We might wish we never had to fight. But sometimes there is no choice. What makes a fight a good fight, and note that qualifier is there, that adjective is there in verse 12, fight the good fight. What makes a fight a good fight? It's a good cause. And the Christian has the best cause of all, the honor and glory of God displayed in the truth of Jesus Christ. Gospel minister must defend the faith. But not only gospel ministers. Every believer must defend the faith. We might do it in different ways, but we're all called to do it. Here's one way in which you are called to defend the faith. Should the day ever come when I lose my mind, and I stand in this pulpit and I begin to preach something other than the truth of Scripture, you defend the faith by getting rid of it. That's on the church. The church's responsibility is to ensure that their leaders remain faithful to the Word of God. Timothy must fight the good fight. He must fight, as every gospel minister must, for the infallibility, the inerrancy, the sufficiency of Scripture, maintaining that the Bible is not the word of man, but the word of God. He must fight for the deity of Jesus Christ, maintaining that Jesus is fully God as well as fully man. He must fight for the depravity of humanity, maintaining that all men and all women are born in sin and misery. And he must fight for the holiness of God, maintaining that God will judge the world in righteousness. He must fight for the efficacy of the substitutionary atonement of Jesus Christ, maintaining that Christ died on the cross in the place of sinners. He must fight for the bodily resurrection, maintaining that Jesus Christ, who died on the cross, rose from the dead. And from beginning to end, he must fight for the sovereignty of God's grace, maintaining that salvation is the choice and the gift of God to the praise of his glory. He must fight for the gospel of grace alone through faith alone in Christ alone, so that those who understand by the grace of God their sin have a remedy. They have a hope to flee to. These are the truths for which we fight. And no sooner has Paul drawn the battle lines than he looks forward to the end of the war entirely. Timothy, fight the good fight of faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called. Here's a fourth rule of engagement for us. Reach for the victory, here described as eternal life. Now, Timothy received eternal life when he first came to faith in Jesus Christ. Every Christian does. Eternal life is God's free gift to everyone who will come to him in repentance, trusting in Jesus Christ and seeking the forgiveness of sins through Christ alone. As Paul mentioned at the beginning of the letter, those who believe on Jesus Christ receive eternal life, 1 Timothy 1:16. But Timothy still needed to take hold of the eternal life. That is, he needed to appropriate it, to grasp it, to hang on to it for all he's worth. This is similar to what Paul says elsewhere. We've got to work out our salvation with fear and trembling. Not work for our salvation, work it out. The salvation is what we possess. Now it has to make a difference. And so we work it out in our lives. Paul's saying much the same thing here to Timothy. Paul tried to do the same thing himself. Philippians chapter 3, verse 12, he says, not that I have already obtained it or have already become perfect, but I press on so that I may lay hold of that for which also I was laid hold of by Christ Jesus. And what we're intended to see from this is that eternal life is for now as well as later. Eternal life is not something we inherit at the end of our lives or at the second coming. If you are in Christ, you already possess eternal life. It is yours. It has begun. Now it's going to get a lot better. But it's begun. And we live in the light of that reality. Eternal life is both a present possession and a future hope. Timothy had the hope of eternal life because he was called to receive it by by the Spirit of God. This is what we refer to as effectual calling. The Spirit of God, at some point in Timothy's life, made him alive, enabled him to hear and to understand the gospel and to believe in Christ. The Spirit of God did that. God's call is, to keep it within the metaphor we're using this morning, God's call is like a military summons. It has an irresistible saving influence on those that God is saving. The Puritans defined effectual calling as the work of God's Spirit, whereby convincing us of our sin and misery, enlightening our minds in the knowledge of Christ, and renewing our wills, he persuades and enables us to embrace Christ as he is freely offered to us in the gospel. Timothy answered this call, we're told, when he made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. There's been a lot of discussion concerning what that means. Some think it refers to Timothy's ordination. I think it refers to his baptism. That's when we make our public confession of faith in Jesus Christ. Timothy's baptism would have taken place in the presence of many witnesses, because Christian baptism has always been, for the most part, with few exceptions, a matter of the public worship of the church. By mentioning the confession this way, Paul is appealing to Timothy's sense of honor. You have made a public confession of Christ. How could you now go back on that? You've made your vow in the presence of the church, as Timothy looked back on that momentous occasion and remembered the faces of his friends and brothers and sisters who had witnessed his baptism. He would be inspired to obey the orders of his Lord. I hope that's how your baptism has affected you. I hope when things get tough, when doubts creep in, you think back to that moment of obedience when you were plunged beneath the water and raised up again. And I hope it reminds you of your commitment to Jesus Christ, of your enlistment in his army. That's what baptism is. It is, in one sense, a public profession of faith made before witnesses, but it's also intended to be a reminder to us of what God has done in our own lives. And if you profess Christ and you have never been baptized, let me put it as plainly as I can. You are living in disobedience to your Lord. Christ told his disciples, go to all the nations and make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Which means, if you're going to be a disciple, you need to be baptized. And since a disciple simply means a learner, and in the New Testament, particularly in the book of Acts, disciple is just a synonym for believer. As a believer, you need to be baptized. And if you haven't been, you need to be. You need to come into obedience to the Lord Jesus Christ. This is my commercial this morning. Come talk to me if you haven't been baptized. If you profess yourself to be a follower of Jesus Christ and have not been baptized, not as a baby, but as a disciple of Jesus Christ, then that needs to be remedied. Well, Timothy's vow would be reason enough to keep on fighting, but Paul gives him an even more solemn charge in verses 13 and 14. I charge you in the presence of God, who gives life to all things, and of Christ Jesus, who testified the good confession before Pontius Pilate, that you keep the commandment without stain or reproach until the appearing of the Lord Jesus Christ. What does Paul mean by commandment? He must have been referring to the things he's just been saying, coming back to verses 11 and 12, or perhaps to the vows that Timothy made at his baptism. J.N.D. Kelly thinks the language of these verses may even come from an early baptismal formula that was used within the early church. The commandment, then, is that the whole law of Christ and the rule of faith and life enjoined by the gospel to which, Timothy, you pledged yourself at your baptism. In case he needs any further encouragement, Paul reminds Timothy that his commander-in-chief, Jesus Christ, made his own confession when he stood before Pontius Pilate. Christ made his confession. Calvin explains that Christ made his confession before Pilate not in many words, but in reality. That is, by his voluntary submission to death. For he ratified his testimony with his own blood and with the sacrifice of his death better than any words could do. Well, the fifth and final rule of engagement that Paul's laying out before Timothy encompasses all the others. Keep fighting to the end. He will bring this about at the proper time. He who is the blessed and only sovereign, the King of Kings, Lord of Lords, who alone possesses immortality and dwells in unapproachable light, whom no man has seen or can see, to him the honor and eternal dominion. Amen. This is Paul's way of saying reinforcements are coming. Help is on the way. So although Timothy must follow his rules of engagement, he will not have to follow them forever. They will remain in force only until the appearing of the Lord Jesus Christ, which will come at the proper time. This summarizes virtually everything anyone needs to know about the second coming of Christ. First, the return of Jesus Christ is definite. It's going to happen. There is no question. Jesus is coming again. And second, when he comes, it will be the proper time. Now, no, Paul doesn't tell Timothy when that time is. Because Paul didn't know. Not even the Lord Jesus knew. But when he does come, it will be the proper time. And that's all we need to worry about. It's all we need to know. There are people who are always trying to figure out when Christ is coming. There's a very simple answer to the question, when is Jesus coming? The answer is, at the right time. You don't know the day or the hour. And you don't know the month or the year. But you know that when he comes, it will be the fullness of time. Exactly the right time. And when he comes, Christ will bring total triumph for the people of God. Our King has promised to come again before the last battle, and when he will come with heavy reinforcements to sweep our enemy from the field. In the meantime, every soldier in God's army must keep fighting the good fight of faith. That's what we are called to do. And here is the victory song. The one who is coming is the blessed and only sovereign. He is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He alone possesses immortality and dwells in unapproachable light, whom no man has seen or can see. To him be honor and eternal dominion forever. This is our God. This is our commanding officer. This is the one we obey. This is the one we follow. And we do until he brings the battle to an end. Father, thank you. We are so grateful, Father, that we are not fighting this battle on our own, Rather, Father, we fight the battle that you have placed before us, and we seek to be obedient, Father, to you in the midst of this battle. Oh, Father, we pray that you would remind us always that this life, as we walk with Christ and seek to serve him, is a fight, and that we must fight this good fight as you have commanded us, not with earthly, fleshly weapons, but with spiritual weapons, through the power of your Spirit and the power of your Word. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand with us together as we conclude our service this morning?
Jesus, draw me ever nearer as I labor through the storm. You have called me to this passage, and I'll follow. May this journey bring a blessing. May I rise on wings of faith, and at the end of my heart's testing, with your life, let me pray. Jesus, guide me through the tempest. Keep my spirit safe and sure. Your lightness, let me
forward to that day when this fight is over and there is rest.
Yes.
Oh, Father, until that day, sustain us and strengthen us for the battle.
Yes.
This we ask in the name of Christ, our Savior, our Lord, our Captain. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you all.